Just put your hand in mine. There ain't nothing in this world I couldn't do.
Yeah.
lonely boy in a gripping lonely world. Someone like you could make my dreams come true. And all the mountains I could climb, if you just put your hand in mine, there ain't nothing in this world I couldn't do.
Sunny in my
a lonely boy in a great big lonely world. Someone like you could make my dreams come true. And all the mountains I could climb if you just put your hand in mine. There ain't nothing in this world I couldn't do.
Thank you. The way I feel about it. Martins are Rothschilds. The Martins are Rothschilds. The Martins are Rothschilds.
Thank you.
Speaking of, they have no more stuff.
Thank you.
please don't let them drain my energy down. The whites may be into 10. The whites may be into 10. Please protect me from them, God. Give me a zone of protection, please. From me, from me. Thank you.
explaining what really happened that day. COVID, eh, the ramp at West Point, that's the one that really gets him in that litany of awful moments last year.
Boy, there were a lot. And what about Joe Biden's prediction that Donald Trump is going to try to steal the election? And then the shocked outrage. Oh, my God, how dare he? He's lost his marbles. And, of course, that's exactly what happened.
Yeah, he predicted that President Biden did back in June as the soon-to-be nominee of the Democratic Party. And unfortunately, that all came to pass, as we saw in the last clip from January 6th.
Yeah, okay, I won't have any more halting questions to you, Willie. Why don't we just bring in the BBC's Caddy Kay. Mika has a morning off. Lucky her. And we're going to be starting, Willie, with this new report on just how far the Trump Justice Department went. And, my God, it seems like they crossed some real boundaries here, right?
Yeah, this is an extraordinary story. Looking at the leaks connected to the Russian investigation from Attorney General Barr and the Justice Department. According to the New York Times, the Justice Department, first under Jeff Sessions, subpoenaed Apple in 2017 and early 2018 for the data of at least a dozen people tied to the House Intelligence Committee, including the top Democrat, Adam Schiff. Democratic Congressman Eric Swalwell also confirms to NBC News his records were seized. The Times reports the records of aides and family members of those connected to the committee also were collected, including those of a minor. No evidence was ever found tying the committee to the leaks. But that did not stop Trump's next attorney general, William Barr, from reviving the investigation a year later. The Times, citing three sources, reports Barr recruited about a half dozen investigators to work on that case. After years of nothing to show for that investigation, the Times reports some in the department began to see it as politically motivated, you think? Barr declined to comment, as did the Biden Justice Department. Congressman Adam Schiff now is calling on the agency's inspector general to investigate.
That is, I think, a terrible abuse of power. It violates, I think, the separation of powers, but it also makes the Department of Justice just a fully owned subsidiary of the president's personal legal interests and political interests. And that does such damage to the department. So it's extraordinary, maybe unprecedented, for the department to seek records like this of a member of Congress or staff of a member of Congress or staff of a committee, to do so in a partisan way, to do so when they're investigating him, to do so openly calling on his department. It's hard to express just how shocking an abuse of power this really is.
So, Joe, what you have here, and we're going to talk to Michael Schmidt in just a moment, one of the reporters from the New York Times on this, is the former attorneys general, both Jeff Sessions and then William Barr, basically assembling a cavalry to go and look inside the Intelligence Committee to see who they thought might be leaking stories to outlets like the New York Times and using subpoena power to do so.
I mean, this seems awfully extraordinary, this news that we're waking up to this morning, and perhaps it's happened before, and maybe those examples just aren't coming to mind. But here, you have an administration, and there's really a parallel with the clip that we played coming in, where you had people shocked and stunned that Joe Biden suggested that Donald Trump is going to try to steal the election if things didn't go his way. Of course, that's exactly what happened. Here, you actually had Donald Trump and everybody around Trump, all of his defenders, screaming and howling about how the, quote, deep state had been spying on them during the transition. At the same time, they're literally spying on members of the press. They're spying on partisan political opponents. And this is what seems new to me. Spying on political rivals in another branch of government. I mean, there's a reason why we have three separate branches of government, and there are checks and balances, and so you actually have Donald Trump's White House, Donald Trump's Justice Department, spying on a separate branch of government that's conducting its oversight role in investigating the executive branch. And like I said, maybe this has happened before, I don't remember this ever happening. If it has happened, it's we don't want to engage in being too melodramatic here, but my God, it just seems to me that this is an extraordinary breach. It is a constitutionally challenging event, again, when an executive branch spies on a legislative branch committee that's doing investigations and oversight on that president. Let's bring in one of the reporters of this story, New York Times reporter and MSNBC national security analyst, Michael Schmidt. He's the author of the great book, Donald Trump versus the United States, Inside the Struggle to Stop a President. We wish enough that Michael was one of the several New York Times reporters who had his own records subpoenaed by the Trump Justice Department. So Michael, we obviously last week expressed concerns about you and other members of the press having their records sifted through by government agencies, leak investigations. That... during the Obama administration, they were very aggressive. I'm trying to remember, though, whether we've ever had a president and his administration spy on members. I'm sure if Nixon didn't do it, he certainly thought about it, but actually spy and seize the records of opponents from another branch that was investigating that president and his administration. It seems like extraordinarily dangerous and new. I'm sort of stammering around this morning because I just think this is new territory.
I think you're right. And as we found in our reporting, we could not find a similar example of this in recent memory. Now, this could have happened in a leak case that we don't know about. There are lots of leaks that are investigated, and there are lots of tactics that are used in them. So, in another matter, sure, maybe this did happen, but we certainly didn't find out about it. So, that sets this apart. You're right. It is different than the subpoenas that we've seen over the years for reporters' phone records. By the way, a tactic now that the Biden Justice Department says they will not follow, even though they were following it up until about a week ago. The thing I think that also sets this apart, certainly in terms of Congress, is that this is exactly what Trump wanted. And this is exactly why presidents are counseled not to talk about ongoing investigations or about how the powers of the Justice Department should be used. Because if something like this were to come out, the first instinct of everyone would say, well, that's exactly what Donald Trump, who was the president, who was the person who could put whoever he wanted at the Justice Department, who at the time, all of his pressure on the Justice Department. You have to remember, this is 2017, 2018. Trump is very angry about the Mueller investigation. Sessions and Rosenstein are afraid they're going to get fired at any turn because they're trying, Rosenstein is saying he's trying to protect Mueller and the Mueller investigation. And it is in that atmosphere that this happens, that the Justice Department takes this extraordinary action to pull the, go to Apple and get the records, the data and information, iCloud information for one of the president's chief rivals, the staff of that rival, and a child for one of the staff members.
It's really unbelievable. And really, this is also the same time when Donald Trump kept telling anybody who would listen to him, that is my Justice Department, that is the Trump Justice Department. I can do whatever he want. He said he could do whatever he wanted to do, and obviously he chose to use that Justice Department to spy on political opponents in another branch of government.
Yeah, and time and again, the Justice Department was all too willing to play that role for President Trump. And Michael, I'm interested if we can take a step back in what the Justice Department was looking for specifically. Okay, you go to Apple, you say, give us these records, give us the metadata. What did they think they were going to find, number one? And there's another compelling piece, part of this story, where you say Apple had a gag order from the Justice Department until just recently, a month or so ago, which is why we're learning from a lot of media outlets about what exactly happened. And also, a couple of months ago was the first time that these members of Congress themselves learned that they had their records subpoenaed because the gag order finally expired on Apple.
So for the Justice Department to have received the gag order in this matter, they almost very likely had to have a federal judge sign off on that. And that's part of this that I think has received less attention, which is that the judicial branch had some role here. And, you know, the Justice Department is obviously the one going out and doing this, but that the judicial branch allowed the Justice Department to keep this secret. That's why we didn't know about it until the past few weeks, where these subpoenas and this action has trickled out. And in that case, really, for example, in the case of the attempts to get my colleagues' information from our email, it was only our general counsel who knew about it for the first several weeks because the court would not allow him to tell anyone. And eventually he received the permission to tell a few people at the Times, but he could not even tell the editor of the New York Times, Dean Baquet. He only found out about this a week ago as this was all becoming public. So the Justice Department was allowed to operate in secrecy in this, which they say was necessary to protect these ongoing investigations because people could try and destroy evidence if they knew that the feds were moving. But also, when things operate in secret, there's a lot less scrutiny. It's a lot easier to hide from the media and others who will question, why are you doing this and what is truly behind that? And it looks like that tactic, that approach was used in regards to Schiff and the others on the Hill.
You know, Caddy Kay, we've talked over the past 5 years about how Republicans in the Senate and the House have just sort of bowed down to Donald Trump, have forgotten that they actually have power themselves, that Article I is a powerful branch of government, and they didn't have to defer to Donald Trump at all points. But oh boy, things have changed so radically. This is a story that really shows that. If this had happened while I was a member of Congress, I guarantee you, and if it were a Republican president that did this, every Republican chairman and chairwoman would stand united and howl and raise hell and make that Republican president pay. They just would, because they actually understood that they were the Article I branch of government. And the United States Constitution laid out those checks and balances, those Madisonian checks and balances. Here, I cannot believe that there are not Republicans in the United States Senate and in the United States House who are terrified by this precedent and what it now means. If they don't speak up now, what it now means about Democratic presidents being able to subpoena their phone records when the Democratic president doesn't like an investigation that perhaps they're looking into. It's a horrible precedent for Republicans and Democrats.
Yeah, I mean, every now and again during the Trump presidency, we had a moment where we thought,
wow, my best friend. One of my favorite posts, advocacy, never matter, just looks like I'm part of a group that people with the beginners put together with anybody's same opportunities. I want to create a more inclusive and acceptable world for you, for you, and you.
Question. There's got to be an explanation.
What we ought to do.
Yes, sir. It's a song.
It's a Beach Boys song.
Wouldn't it be nice? You're the girl with the dead family, or you sit.
Here they come.
Hear it for me.
I'm posing. While she sleeps, she turns into a wolf.
I'm begging you to come back to me. The world deserves to see this. I do believe you have just had a breakthrough.
We fight for freedom.
The movies will control to the darkness. Had done this, what would be the reaction from the other side? Imagine this story coming out and it was Barack Obama who had been trying to silence journalists, subpoena members of Congress to get their phone records, including a minor. All hell would have broken loose in the Republican Party. It's clear that that's the case. But it's the degree to which Donald Trump seemed to feel that the Justice Department was his Justice Department, and the care with which they went to muzzle the journalists and muzzle their ability to expose this story in real time by setting up these gag orders within the news organizations. And Michael Schmidt, I was just looking at what Eric Swalwell, who's one of those who'd had his records subpoenaed, said. This, you know, it feels like a Donald Trump-driven investigation, and I don't think have a lot of faith in his ability to fairly interpret the law. Now, that's Eric Swalwell saying this was not the Justice Department, this was Donald Trump. But from everything we know of what Donald Trump said, even in public, about how he viewed the Justice Department, there's little doubt, is there, that this was coming from the White House.
Well, we don't know everything that went into these requests and this action. We do know that at certain points, federal judges should have been involved in it, and that certainly if the Justice Department was following its guidelines, they would not pursue matters like this without evidence or some strong suspicion to get them there. But at the heart of the problem here is the fact that the person in charge of all of these people, the head of the executive branch, was standing on the highest point in the country with a megaphone saying, this is what I want. Trump did not hide this. It's not like we found out about that Trump, you know, quietly said this somewhere. Trump was publicly going after these people. He was using his position as the President of the United States to try and push the Justice Department to go after the people he did not like. And he complained and complained and complained about it. So now that we find out that his Justice Department, that was controlled by his political appointees, did this, we have to question, why is it that it happened? We know that Jeff Sessions and Rod Rosenstein were terrified that they were going to get fired in this period of time. Now that puts an enormous pressure on a day-to-day basis on the department. What I'm interested to see is that how did the Justice Department get there? How did they make these decisions? We do not have full visibility into that today.
All right, Michael Schmidt, thank you so much for your reporting. My God, what a story. And Willie, it bears repeating that these weren't just people that Donald Trump didn't like. These weren't just political rivals of Donald Trump. These were people who were investigating Donald Trump. They were in the middle of an investigation. He was trying to do whatever he could to stop the investigation, and now we find out he even went to the extraordinary length. His Justice Department went to the extraordinary length to seize their records.
even as Michael reports in the piece, even as Justice Department officials came back to Attorney General Barr and said, it doesn't look like there's anything here, we're not going to have enough to bring charges, Attorney General Barr insisted they continue their investigation, going back to your larger point about the Justice Department doing the bidding of President Trump. Let's turn to a potential, underlying potential breakthrough in the infrastructure negotiations on Capitol Hill. A bipartisan group of senators working on a deal says it now has made some progress.
Each of us have reached a tentative understanding, and so we're not looking for adjustments. What we're looking for is to see whether our colleagues are open to it, and we'll finally get out a piece of paper which lays it all out, and then see if we can get some people to sign on and have enough support to think it has merit.
So let's turn to NBC News Capitol Hill correspondent Garrett Haake, who's been reporting on this story. Garrett, good morning, good to see you. So, tentative understanding, not exactly a resounding conclusion to these negotiations, but what are they talking about here? What is this framework? And as always with this negotiation, how are they going to pay for it?
Well, Willie, I talked to Susan Collins about this late yesterday, and she made a point of warning me not to overstate where they are on this, so I appreciate the caveat at the top here. They still, this group of 10 senators, 5 Republicans, 5 Democrats, know they have to sell what they've come up with, not just to their respective caucuses, but also to the White House if they're going to get anywhere, and I think that's some of the hesitation. But what I can tell you is in this plan is it gets up above $1 trillion in total spending, particularly when you stretch it out over the 8-year mark. That's a kind of a deal that was worked out with the Biden administration, whether it was going to be 5 years or 8 years. This bill can be stretched out to 8. It deals with just physical infrastructure, so the elements about the care economy that the White House had wanted to see in the jobs plan get all the way through Congress is not included in this. And the way that the group tried to come up with to pay for it involves a mix of things like the unspent COVID relief money that was talked about in the Shelley Moore Capito plan. They also try to do some creative things with taxes, and I think this is where this may get hung up with the administration. For example, they index the gas tax to inflation. They say this is not a tax increase. Well, if there is inflation and the gas tax goes up, the tax will go up. But these members can say, we didn't raise it, we simply indexed it to inflation. Will that fly with the White House? I have no idea, but I can tell you that it's already not flying with progressive Democrats. Rob Wyden, the chairman of the Senate Finance Committee, was panning this plan before it was even released. It still isn't released in its entirety. He basically said, this ain't it. So there are Democrats who are still itching to go forward with a much bigger plan here, but the fact that this is bipartisan, that it does have the buy-in of at least these 5 Republican senators, gives, I think, hope to those who want a bipartisan deal, including the President of the United States. The White House said they're looking this over, and they have questions, Willie. So we'll see to what degree the bipartisan group can answer those questions, and whether this moment in the sun for them continues and they continue to negotiate through next week, or if the White House or enough progressive Democrats come forward and say, this isn't going to cut the mustard, we've got to find something else.
Well, I'll tell you what, $1.2 trillion ain't nothing in the fact that people suggest that it's too small of a sum for infrastructure. I guess that tells you exactly where we are right now politically. Garrett, let me also ask you about the police reform bill. We had been hearing that that might be moving toward compromise, that bipartisan compromise, but it's in a snag. What's that snag?
Yeah, of all the bipartisan negotiations going on the Hill, the police reform one is the one that I and a number of reporters up there have been the most bullish about, in part because they have kept the details locked down. The 3 lawmakers who've been working on this closely, really going back to late last year, have been running a very tight ship, and we were told early this week that they had actually started circulating text among themselves, that they thought they might be close enough to an agreement to actually start putting something down on paper in legislative text. That's a big deal in D.C. But what has come up to the forefront here as they've started looking at this text is, and this is coming from Republican sources, including Lindsey Graham, who has been tangentially involved in this, working with Tim Scott, saying that the negotiators had largely agreed, they thought, the Republicans thought, that they were going to leave something called Section 242 out of this. This deals with U.S. code about how a government official could potentially be charged for depriving a person of their constitutional rights. Republicans didn't want to touch this in the negotiations, and they thought they had convinced Democrats that this was going to be left aside and that they could move forward on the things on which they agreed. Apparently not so in the text that had been passed around.
So, Gary, decision to re-engage on this, Joe. Yeah, in plain English, that's whether an individual police officer would be held liable for something that happened while he was in his job. And I know that the Democrats and Republicans have been talking about actually making it the municipality that would be liable.
No, this is not the same as qualified immunity. They actually think they got past this. This deals with depriving a person of constitutional rights. It's almost never charged. And this is one of the things where Democrats have wanted to beef up this provision as another way to potentially hold police officers accountable by going through this kind of separate door. The Republicans didn't want to touch that. They didn't want to change this provision. In fact, the qualified immunity portion, Joe, that you were talking about, seems to have been settled. And I think that was part of the reason there was so much optimism here, because for so long we had thought that would be the most difficult part of these negotiations.
NBC's Garrett Hake, as you say, this was the one place we thought there was some movement in Congress. Seems to have slowed a bit there. We'll be keeping in touch with you on all these stories. Thanks so much, Garrett. Meanwhile, President Biden continues his overseas trip as the G7 summit kicks off today in Cornwall, England. Yesterday, President Biden and British Prime Minister Boris Johnson met and reaffirmed a World War II era charter aimed at strengthening ties between the longtime allies.
It's wonderful to listen to the Biden administration and to Joe Biden, because there's so much that they want to do together with us, from security, NATO, to climate change, and it's fantastic. It's a breath of fresh air.
Prime Minister Johnson and I had a very productive meeting. We affirmed the special relationship, as is not said lightly, the special relationship between our people. And we renewed our commitment to defending the enduring democratic values that both our nations share.
Let's bring in two reporters traveling with the president, White House reporter for the Associated Press, Jonathan Lemire, and NBC News White House correspondent, Mike Memley. Good morning to you both. Mike, I'll start with you. What are we hearing from the White House? What are we hearing from President Biden himself about the focus and the plans for the G summit that starts very shortly today?
Well, really, so much of the buildup to this trip, the first trip abroad by President Biden since taking office, has been about the final stop, of course, which is that meeting in Geneva with Russian President Vladimir Putin. But what we are going to see today when the president meets with the fellow G7 leaders, and what we saw a bit of yesterday as well as he met with Boris Johnson, the prime minister here in the UK, was a really important reestablishment of the U.S. relationship with our Western allies. Now, you remember the president, when he arrived here, reiterated something we've heard a lot, which is America is back. And one of the big questions our key allies are asking is, yes, but for how long? And so as I've been talking to White House officials and those close to Biden, they talk so much about how his mantra that all politics is personal really does apply as well to foreign policy. And in some ways, while that could pay dividends in the relationships he's built with China's President Xi Jinping, and also the difficult interactions he's had in the past with Vladimir Putin, it's more critical today for President Biden to be able to react to and assure our allies that the United States, the commitment to democratic principles, is one that they can commit to themselves in the long term. Now, the agenda is quite full. They are going to be focused on the pandemic, the announcement from the U.S. yesterday, President Biden announcing 500 million doses of the Pfizer vaccine to be shipped out, especially to poor and developing nations. Climate is going to be a big focus, especially tonight when we see the leaders dine with members of the royal family, including the Queen. She will be a late addition to that party as well. But a focus on what the president has been talking so much about, which is a foreign policy for the middle class, the economy, the president seeking to bring Western allies on board with a global minimum tax that would be regardless of where a company is headquartered, to ensure that they're paying at least a 15% tax to the countries in which they do business. It's part of what the president has tried to assure our allies is in their interest, which is to build a strong middle class, which is the foundation of a strong democracy.
Okay.
Yeah. Mike, you know, it's tempting to look at these global conferences and think nothing really ever comes out of them, right? And after 4 years of put on pause, is this going to be different this time around? Do you think we're going to come out of this G7 meeting in Cornwall with actual real changes on issues like climate change, on issues like how to deal with Russia, China and cybersecurity, and particularly on the pandemic? In a sense, after the sort of disruption of Donald Trump, is the world now really ready and waiting to take action again to make things better?
This has been a critical focus from the U.S. side ahead of the summit here, which is you need to be able to provide tangible results. You need to be able to show that democracies can still get things done. And that's why the U.S. commitment of 500 million doses of the COVID vaccine is being matched. In fact, there's going to be an announcement of 1 billion doses overall by the G7 countries being shared. They want to see even further steps toward a strengthening of the Paris Climate Agreement. That's going to be a part of the discussion here. That's been the way the president has focused here. But I think it was interesting, as we saw the meeting with Prime Minister Johnson yesterday, I thought back to what President Biden, then candidate Biden, said during the campaign when Johnson won the parliamentary victory, which was he called Johnson an emotional clone of Donald Trump, and he warned that if his own party, Democrats, moved too far to the left, they would suffer the same fate as the Labour Party had in the elections here. And so you see Biden trying to walk that middle ground in domestic politics, and he's trying to do the same in this diplomatic context to make sure our allies are doing just as much as he's trying to do back home in nuts and bolts and getting the results in order to prevent the rise of populist figures and even authoritarian figures, as we've seen in the past as well.
That evening primrose oil really is special.
We will get to the reaction from the good people of Cornwall to the Red Sox remarkable comeback last night against the Houston Astros in just a minute. But first, you look at these pictures. You look at Joe Biden, the Boris Johnson response. What a marked contrast between Donald Trump and Theresa May. Sort of the seething resentment. Of course, G7, there's
some regular things.
Moment, if you're a complete fuck of the American president pushing the president, I believe it was Montenegro, out of the way.
I didn't put enough makeup back
at the summit. A bit different this year, isn't it?
Yes, Joe, as I said, I traveled with President Trump on a few of his journeys to the G7 when he was in office, and it was sort of a rite of passage that he would start bashing Theresa May as Air Force One was about to descend into when he would meet with the British Prime Minister. He obviously had a better relationship with Boris Johnson, and that shadowed this event. We know that President Biden was very critical of Johnson in the past. There was, you know, certainly some tension, and that it still exists, differences of opinion on how the Northern Ireland issue should be handled here, but that was all set aside yesterday. It was real warmth between the two men, both sides really stressing common ground, not their differences, either personally or politically. We even had President Biden gift Boris Johnson a bike and a helmet, since the two men share enthusiasm for cycling. But they renewed this Atlantic Charter. They announced the working group to reopen travel between the two nations. As Mike mentioned, who, by the way, has a much better backdrop than I do, their commitments to the vaccines for the poor parts of the world. So this was yesterday, obviously one of the United States' closest, most enduring alliances, and we know how much Joe Biden believes in that, and needing to show that the U.S.-UK alliance is strong as a linchpin as he tries to get the West moving together to prove that it can compete with authoritarians around the world.
All right, well, Jonathan, we're staying with us. We'll get to the Red Sox also. Of course, we love your great reporting as well as Willie. Those curtains behind you, and I mean, we still figured out the pattern there. It's sort of the geometry problem or something. It's very
probably the Continental Breakfast Bar at the Courtyard by Marriott in Plymouth, England, if I'm reading the background correctly, Jonathan.
Willie,
I'll have you know that it's actually a painted wall, even though it looks curtain-ish, and it's sort of not the theme, which is the best that we could do here at the
main menu. To listen to your messages, press 1. To send a message, Just put your hand in mine, there ain't nothing in this world I couldn't do. I let
Pretty long.